Today, we're continuing Treated Like Trash, our investigation into the 2008 death of Amanda Wienckowski. This is a case that should enrage you, and not only because of the brutal way that Amanda was killed, but because of the brutality with which Erie County, New York, treated her family as they sought justice for Amanda, their daughter, sister, and friend. If this is the first time you've heard about this case, I suggest you go back and watch or listen to the previous four episodes. In them, you'll discover that police believed that Amanda Wienckowski was murdered by a man named Antoine Garner, but that he was never prosecuted because the Erie County Medical Examiner's Office, for some inexplicable reason, ruled her death an accidental opioid overdose. Please subscribe if you haven't already, because even after 12 years of seeking justice for Amanda, this ride is just getting started. Today, we're going to ignore most of the facts of the case. Not because they're unimportant, but because we've come to the realization that none of them matter unless we can get past this one simple thing. That nothing will change in this case unless we can prove that Amanda Wienckowski did not die of an opioid overdose. So forget that Amanda was found naked and frozen solid in a Buffalo, New York trash can. Forget that she had strangulation bruises on her neck. Forget that her neck was crushed. Forget that those injuries weren't included in the autopsy report done by Erie County Medical Examiner Dianne Vertes. Forget that Erie County concealed the neck injuries by not putting her neck organs, including her larynx, trachea, tongue, and hyoid bone, into the bag of other organs that were buried with Amanda's body. Forget that Erie County fought tooth and nail when Amanda's mom sued to get access to Amanda's neck organs. Forget that Amanda was last seen entering the house of Antoine Garner. Forget that Antoine Garner had a history of strangling and raping women. Forget all of it. For the rest of this episode, we're going to be laser focused on one task. We're going to prove that Amanda Wienckowski did not die of an opioid overdose. And the funny thing is, it's not even going to be hard. So stick around. The first thing you need to know is that Amanda Wienckowski's drug of choice, the drug that she was addicted to and that her body had become dependent on, was heroin. But she had recently cleaned up with the help of her mom, and she had enrolled in classes at Niagara County Community College. We're going to talk chemistry here for a minute, and we're going to keep it simple because that's the level at which I understand it. But specifically, I want to talk about what happens to heroin when it gets into the human body. In Amanda's case, she injected it directly into the bloodstream. Heroin is almost the exact same thing as morphine. The difference is that there are two acetyl groups in heroin molecules that aren't in morphine. These groups work to increase the half-life of the molecule, making heroin's effects last longer than morphine. Now, when heroin enters the body, one of the acetyl groups gets hydrolyzed spontaneously. No metabolism has taken place in the way that most of us think of it. What I mean is no enzymes make this happen. Basically, it just gets wet, and that converts the heroin molecule into what's called a monoacetylmorphine. Specifically, it's either 6-monoacetylmorphine or 3-monoacetylmorphine, depending on which acetyl group gets hydrolyzed. Next, enzymes in the blood, liver, and brain catalyze that second acetyl group, and the 6 or 3-monoacetylmorphine is then converted into morphine. Morphine then binds to the opioid receptors in the brain, which triggers the release of dopamine. And that makes the user feel an intense rush of euphoria, among other sensations. Many people don't know this, but the human body actually produces morphine itself, but at very low levels. When high levels of morphine are introduced to the body, there's a detection system that knows there's too much morphine in it. So it starts toward getting rid of the drug by flushing it out through the urinary system. And this is why urine drug tests are commonly used by opioid recovery clinics as a way to know if a patient has been using heroin. They look for two things in the urine. You guessed it, morphine and monoacetylmorphine. Usually toxicology labs test for 6-monoacetylmorphine. Now there are a lot of variables that go into the metabolism of heroin, but in general, morphine is flushed out of the system through the urinary tract in about 7 days. 6-monoacetylmorphine, however, is completely flushed out of the system in about 24 hours. So when heroin recovery clinics test a patient's urine and they find 6-monoacetylmorphine in that urine, they know that their patient has taken heroin sometime in the previous 24 hours. Now, forensic toxicology labs are full of very smart people with lots of experience. So they have standard tests that they use to test the blood, bile, brain tissue, liver tissue, gastric contents, and yes, the urine of the bodies of the victims that come into the medical examiner's office. See what's listed very first right there? 6-monoacetylmorphine. And look, 6-monoacetylmorphine is something that they were looking for on Amanda's toxicology report. It came back negative, which means no 6-monoacetylmorphine was in Amanda's urine. I know what you're thinking right now. You're thinking if Amanda Wienckowski's urine didn't have any 6-monoacetylmorphine in it, then she couldn't have overdosed on heroin. And you're right. But I also know what lawyers are thinking right now. They're thinking, I could make the argument that her urine didn't have 6-monoacetylmorphine in it because it metabolized into morphine between the time she died and the time her body was found. Lawyers think that way. And yes, they could make that argument. But let me tell you the reason why that argument is stupid. First, remember that heroin is hydrolyzed into 6-monoacetylmorphine. It doesn't require any enzyme to do that, just add water. In order to metabolize further from 6-monoacetylmorphine into morphine, enzymes from red blood cells or brain or liver tissue must be present. Also remember that Amanda was found frozen solid. That means that her urine was frozen too. And that freezing process keeps metabolites and other compounds from degrading. In fact, one study shows that if you keep 6-monoacetylmorphine at sub-zero temperatures, it stores perfectly fine for up to 18 years. So the fact that Amanda was found frozen supports the evidence that she could not have taken heroin in the last 24 hours of her life, making it impossible for her to have overdosed. Guys, medical examiner's offices don't make mistakes like this. You and I may not have known prior to this video that the absence of 6-monoacetylmorphine in Amanda's urine means she didn't overdose. But the four pathologists, the educated and experienced medical doctors, the very ones who signed off on that sloppy autopsy report that you can find on our website, those guys, they knew. So let's go back to the beginning of this video. Remember when I told you to forget that Amanda was found naked and frozen solid in a Buffalo, New York trash can? To forget that she had strangulation bruises on her neck? To forget that her neck was crushed? To forget that those injuries weren't included in the autopsy report done by Erie County Medical Examiner Dianne Vertes, which was signed by 3 other pathologists? To forget that Erie County concealed the neck injuries by not putting her neck organs, including her larynx, trachea, tongue, and hyoid bone, into the bag of other organs that were buried with Amanda's body. To forget that Erie County fought tooth and nail when Amanda's mom sued to get access to Amanda's neck organs. To forget that Amanda was last seen entering the house of Antoine Garner. To forget that Antoine Garner had a history of strangling and raping women. Remember that? I take it back. We can't forget any of it. Now that we know beyond doubt that Amanda didn't die of an overdose, and that we can prove it, The Erie County Medical Examiner's Office must change Amanda's cause of death from accidental overdose to homicide by strangulation. And the Erie County District Attorney must prosecute the person responsible. I believe, and the Buffalo PD certainly believed when they were investigating the case, that it's Antoine Garner. Help us put pressure on both offices, the DA and the ME. Let's just make this injustice go away. Please join Amanda's army by visiting her case page on our website and by clicking that Join Now button at the top of the page. Thank you very much for watching this video. If you liked what you saw, please subscribe to my channel. And if you have any comments or questions, please leave them below.